I was asked by one of the super community how these image mask effects on the Abbotsford Convent site worked. Something that looks like this. They're custom made, and you can see every image has this really cool effect on it. Now, this isn't the only site that uses image masking. There's places like Creative License in Progress. But for us, what we want to do is all these kind of different masking effects. Now, what we're going to make is basically something that looks like this. I've made a dating blog for some reason, and on here we have our own image mask effect. So in today's tutorial, we're going to talk all about masks. So we have to start somewhere, right? So what I've just quickly done is I've made a dating blog. Not really sure why I did a dating blog, but let's go with it. And it looks something like this. So what we have here is our images have no masking and no clipping on them. And of course, because this is a blog, there's a lot of different articles in here. So the first question you might have is, why don't we just prepare the images? Why don't we do it in Figma and say, let's add some masking on there and export them one by one? Well, what happens if you want to change the design of the blog later on? Don't we have to then go and export all the images? And the other reason is, what happens if we're using a content management system and someone else is uploading images in here as well? What happens if we have users adding blog posts, for instance? So how would they add that clipping on there? So we want a bit of control over how our images look, mainly for future reasons, but also more control as well. So how do we go about doing this? Well, let's first look at the site itself. In our HTML, it's fairly basic. We've got a header, which is this area up here, and we have a section, which is our main area. In our section, we have a figure, and that's basically an individual blog post with an image and a caption. Image, caption, image, caption. Our CSS is fairly simple as well. We can see at the top, we've just got some typography, some color. We're setting up our typography and the usual kind of layout stuff. And basically, we just have a fairly simple layout. And what we want to do is clip these images. Now, there is a quick way to do this if we don't want something that's a bit more custom. We can see if we just look up CSS clip path, we can use things like circle, ellipse, and polygon to actually play around with this. So we can have these simple shapes. So let's just try this out. So on our figure image, I'm just going to add in here clip dash path. And let's make it a circle, let's say. Circle and make this 50%. And let's see how that looks. So what we'll get on our site is something that looks like this. We have a circle at 50%. Now, what we can also do is add in an ellipse here. And again, this is an ellipse saying how big it is at a certain point. So for us, we want it to be an ellipse that takes up 50% of X and 50% of Y. I want to start it at in the middle at 50 and 50%. So this is starting in the middle, and it's basically stretching to the edges. So what we see now is we have kind of like an egg, but we have kind of an ellipse. What we could also do is use things like polygon as well to make these kind of simple-ish shapes. But what happens if we want to make something more complex? So let's say we're in Figma and we want to prepare something instead. So jumping over to Figma, what happens if I want to do a squiggle here? You can be my video, missus. Do you want to be in my video? Yeah? She wants to be in my video. So what happens if we just want to do a squiggle mask over each image? So let's just pretend what we're doing. So I'm just going to quickly select the pencil tool in Figma, and I'm just going to draw a squiggle over the top, just a kind of wavy kind of pattern, something like that. And I'm going to select the vector and just thicken it up. So let's pretend our squiggle looks something like this. Now, of course, we can kind of play around with this as well. We could also see the mask in Figma by actually switching the photo to be a higher level. And then I'm just going to select both, right click and use as mask. Is this kind of what we want? Well, maybe we want it to be thicker as well. So I'm just going to make that vector a little bit heavier to get rid of this like dash in the middle. There we go. That looks a little bit nicer. I might want to move it up, for instance, as well, just to kind of position it in the correct place so I can play around something like that. Now, what I want to do is use this vector in my code instead of it being, you know, a circle or something basic. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this vector and unmask it by just taking it back to what we had originally. I need to use as mask. There we go, back to normal. So this is what we had from before. What I'm going to do is just take this and use this as a mask instead. First thing I'm going to do, because this is a stroke, is I'm going to right click and do outline stroke. So what we'll get now is essentially a shape. And we can see the edges of the shape here. We could potentially remove things in here if we wanted to. I'm just going to make this kind of the same size as the box itself, just to kind of fill more space and kind of we have other images in here and we have something like this. Now, what we want to do here is basically use this mask on every single image for now. Now, the way that we can do this is we're going to select this vector in Figma. And I'm going to basically go to constraints and make this stretch or scale. So I'm going to go from left to scale and top to scale as well. Now, what I'm going to do is actually use this in something that we're going to use in our code. And what we're going to do here is basically make something very, very small. Now, the reasons will become clear a little bit later. So I'm going to make a very, 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 very small artboard. So I'm going to make an artboard and I'm going to make this 1 by 1. So 1 pixel, I'm going to call this a name. This is our kind of clippy, let's call it. I've got a vector here that I don't need. And this clippy is 1 by 1. And I'm going to take this vector and I'm going to put it into my clippy, which is really big. And then I'm going to make this 1 by 1, 1 by 1. So what we get if we zoom all the way in, it's almost like a squashed version of this. This isn't as kind of, you know, because the aspect ratio has changed, we're scaling it down instead. But what we're gonna do is use this in our code instead. So what we're gonna do is on Clippy, I'm gonna export this as an SVG and I'm gonna save it to my project. So let's go and find my project. There it is. And I'm gonna save this Clippy.svg into this project. So what we get now is this Clippy.svg. Now this looks like this. This is the kind of underlying code behind an SVG. It's kind of like HTML pretty much. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna use this path in here to basically kind of define what my clip path is in my code. How do we do this? So I'm gonna go back to my index.html and at the very, very top of our body, so I'm just gonna add some space here, is I'm gonna make my own SVG for clipping things. So I'm gonna make an SVG tag from scratch. I'm going to give this a name, class equals, call it Clippy maybe. And what I want to do here is define anything that clips. So I'm going to define in here by using depths and open this up. Now, what do I want to define in our SVG? I want to define some clipping paths. You know, we used in our style.css clip path. Here is what we want to define as clip paths. So here, I'm going to add a new tag called clip path with a capital P. Now I want to give this clip path a name, something like squiggle. So I'm going to give it an ID equal to squiggle. Maybe let's call it clip dash squiggle instead, just to make sure it's the clip path. Now, what do I want to put in this clip path? Well, I want to put in some of my code from Figma. So I'm going to go to my clippy.svg and get this line for this path here. I'm going to copy this and put it into my index.html inside my clip path, something that looks very long like this. Now, because this is 1 by 1 right now, it might appear on the page what we have here, if I refresh, it's technically very, very small because our SVG is very, very small as well. But I definitely don't want this to be here. So I'm just going to basically add some style to make it disappear. So in my code, I'm going to do svg.clippy and then say position absolutes. And then I'm just going to put it top minus 999 pixels and left minus 999 pixels, make it a width of 0 and a height of 0. I don't really want to see that SVG. I want to use that SVG instead. So at the moment, our things are still circles or ellipses because that's what we're using. But what I want to do next is use my clip squiggle in my clip path. So what I'm going to do is go back to my style.css and replace my ellipse with URL, round brackets, and then the ID. So hash clip squiggle. So if I save it now, let's see what happens. So currently they've all disappeared. Now the reason why they've all disappeared is we're clipping just this top pixel. There's actually a tiny little dot in the corner of each one, which you might not be able to see because this is a 1 by 1. But what I want to do is basically stretch this clip path to be around the object itself. So to do this, I'm just going to quickly go back to my index.html. And on my clip path, I'm going to add something called clip path units. And this is going to be equal to an object bounding box. So this is something that's deep within the SVG libraries. It's kind of hard to find, but it's actually a really useful tool. So if I save it now, what we'll see is we have a squiggle that looks like this. Now, what I could do then is start to build this up. So back in Figma, I'm going to go back to my squiggle on the right. I've got this tiny little one down here. But let's say I want to do something a little bit like the Abbotsford Convent, something that looks maybe like one of these. So let's just try this out. I'm going to delete this and replace it with maybe something like an egg kind of shape. So maybe a kind of circle that looks like this. Again, I'm doing this on the fly, and this might look terrible, but we'll give it a go, and we'll copy this. Maybe let's make that top one a little smaller. This is almost like a snowman kind of effect. There we go. I'm going to join these two together as a union. So up here, I'm going to union select. So this is what I want as a kind of shape, and then I want to scale it down. So I'm going to go to constraints and scale on both, and I'm going to copy this union into my tiny little clippy shape, which is all the way down here. I'm going to keep this one in here for now. So I'm going to select clippy and paste. It needs to be, currently it's really big. You can see this is one by one. So our snowman is a little bit smaller in here. I'm going to export clippy again and put it in the same folder and replace. And what we'll see in my clippy path now, my clippy.svg, is now two paths, the original one and now a new one at number 5. So what I'm going to do in my index.html is just prepare this. Inside my defs, I'm going to make a new clip path, and I'm going to give this an ID equal to clip dash snowman. And we also need to give it this clip path units as well, clip path units. This is going to be equal to the same thing. It's going to be an object bounding box, object bounding box. And then all I'm going to do is take this second path in here and paste this in. Now, what I can do is use the snowman one on this everywhere. So for instance, on style.css, instead of it clip dash squiggle, it's now clip dash snowman. And I'm going to save. And what we'll get is on our site, the snowman effect. Now, what I might want to do is use different ones on different places. So for instance, what I could do is then just start adding classes. So what I can say is on figure number one, I could say class equals squiggle. And then on figure number two, class equals snowman. And then I could leave it as blank on the other ones to be like, don't clip at all. And let's just do this. So here I'm going to get rid of clip path on the general ones. But if there's a figure with the class of squiggle on the image, what I want to do is the clip path with the URL ID, which is hash clip dash squiggle. And if I want to do the figure with the class of snowman, space image clip path URL and a hash clip snowman. So what we'll get now is we have a squiggle and then a snowman, and then that unclipped version here as well. So what we want to do is kind of build this up. So I'll do just one more. So let's go and add in something that looks a little bit more like the ones on the Abbotsford site. So maybe what I want to do is something like a rectangle and a circle. Let's try that one. Rectangle and a circle, or an ellipse, and something kind of like that. Maybe let's make this a bit taller. There we go. I'm going to select them both. I'm going to make them a union because I want them to be one shape. And then I'm going to make them scale and scale, scale and scale. I'm going to copy this into my clippy, and it's really small, so I want to make it one by one. And on clippy, I'm going to export again. And what we'll get is now a third path in our clippy.svg. There it is on line 6. I'm going to copy this into my index and the same thing. So quickly, clip path ID, clip, let's call it window, let's say, clip path units is going to be that object bounded box. And let's just paste that in. And now what we can do is use a class of window, let's say, on the figure. And let's just add in our stat sheet. So now what we can do is figure window, not woman, and a clip path of URL hash clip window. And what we'll get is this should add this window shape in here as well. So what we can do is just quickly add these shapes to basically add this image masking in. So we're using a combination of CSS and figure to make this effect, but it's a very powerful and a quick effect to use. So I hope you enjoyed this quick tutorial. This was again requested by someone in the CPI community. If there's anything you want me to cover in the future, please add it in the comments below. Like and subscribe and do all the usual things, and there should be two more videos up here.